Ranger got here just in the nick of time. What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir.
Ain't we just?
What is that called?
That's an alien, bruv. Believe it. And I landed in the wrong place, though. You get the wrong place.
Welcome to London, mof.
And by the way, YOURE means you are. YOUR means you're.
You know, I can't believe I even thought of getting back together with you. We are so over.
Fine by me.
Hey, those little spelling tips will come in handy when you're at home on Saturday nights playing Scrabble with Monica.
Hey.
Sorry. I just feel bad about all that sleep you're gonna miss wishing you were with me.
Oh, no, don't you worry about me falling asleep. I still have your letter!
And hey, just so you know, it's not that common, it doesn't happen to every guy, and it is a big deal!
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, the film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I am kind of excited about the Friends reunion.
Hi, I'm producer Dave. I'm interested about the reunion, but it's been a long time since they've actually been on screen.
And well, that's the thing. They're all of them in very, very like small bits have been in different things. It haven't obviously none of them have done anything that has really taken off as much as Friends has. Now, anybody who has lived under a rock and has no idea what we're talking about when we're talking about Friends. Friends was a TV show that ran from, if I'm not mistaken, the early 90s. It went from like 93, 94, all the way to 2002. I believe the final episode was in 2002. I liked it. I really liked it. A lot of young people are watching it these days and targeting things that are not appropriate anymore. Fair enough. Yes, there's all that argument to be had, but we'll move that to one side. But yeah, so I liked it. It had actors such as Matt LeBlanc, David Schwimmer, Jennifer Aniston.
Aniston.
Yes. Courtney Cox. I keep mistaking them for their character names. Matthew Perry, and the last one, Lisa Kudrow. Oof, nailed it. So all of those people, they played Ross, Rachel, Monica, Chandler, Phoebe, and Joey. Really, really enjoyed the show.
Don't forget, it made film stars of all of them.
Jennifer Aniston
became Mrs. Brad Pitt for a while as well as a result of that. And it was a big thing.
It was a big thing. They all went, I think Jennifer Aniston was the only one that really had a big-ish film career. Courtney Cox kind of was successful with the Scream movies, but again, I mean, she wasn't leading the Scream movies, so she wasn't really a headliner. Lisa Kudrow went more for the indie darlings, indie films. What's his name? Matt LeBlanc tried a couple of TV films or a couple of films, and then he got so rich, he just literally, I think he retired at one point and then got dragged back into it. But he did a show I really, really love called Episodes. It was
a British TV thing, wasn't it?
It is a British TV thing, but it's kind of set in Los Angeles. So I think that's where they went to go shoot it. Mixture of British actors and American actors. And it's about this couple who make it big in British TV with a particular TV show. And it gets acquired by an American studio. So they bring them over and they think, oh, they're just going to remake it in America. And it's going to be great. And they hire Matt LeBlanc, and he plays himself, right? He plays himself as the main character of the TV show, which is completely against the writers, the writers' vision of who they want to play it, and so on. And it's a really great show. I guess obviously it's hyper realistic, if you will, but a lot of people have said it's actually quite accurate of what TV studio life is like. as in like being in the TV industry. So I really, really enjoyed it. So that was one thing from him. I know David Schwimmer. Yeah, Dave Schwimmer. He's currently on TV at the moment with a show called Intelligence. I believe it's called Intelligence. I may be mistaken. It's a British TV show. It's on Sky, where he plays an American CIA agent who comes to join the British MI5, I believe. It's a comedy because they essentially the CIA are trying to get rid of him, so they send him to come and join the British, and that's what it is. It's funny. It is funny.
I think most people will see him in the adverts on TV for
some, yes. He's been doing some adverts recently, right? So I mean, and all of that is just to say, after like, you know, from the show got closed or finished off in 2002 at the very latest, and what are we in? We're approaching 2022, so 20 years later they do a reunion. But I don't think it's a reunion episode, as in the characters come together. I've seen the trailer for it. And I think it's more a case of, James Corden is just interviewing them, and they come together and they, as you know, the actors are coming and reminiscing on how, you know, how it was during the episode. I think they bring a few special guests to come on and so on. The trailer's on YouTube and on IMDb, so you can check it out to see exactly what kind of feel it is. I caught the trailer and I was like, oh, it's nice. You sit back and you can reminisce, right, and catch some of the episodes and whatnot. But it's still a show that I still watch every now and again when it's on, and I still laugh at it. I think it's still funny, even as inappropriate as a lot of the things that pop up that they keep talking about are. I still laugh at the show. I think it's funny. I think they did very well. I don't know if they'll do anything as big as what they did back then, but hey. That's not what it's about, right? It's about reminiscing and remembering a TV show that you really enjoyed. But you said you're not really that much into it.
I never said I'm not that much into it. I did watch it at the time, but okay. I haven't seen it for a long time. I mean, it was repeated on a loop on Channel 4, then on E4, and now I think it's on Netflix, or it's gone to HBO, one of those other channels. So I haven't seen it for a little while, but it's okay. I enjoyed it. There were some episodes I really enjoyed. We were on a break.
That's a reoccurring. Any Friends fan or anyone who's even remotely aware of the Friends TV show knows about it. We were on a break and a whole bunch of other things in there. But you know, that's just me. I want to catch it out. I want to see it just to reminisce, and then I'll completely forget about it. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And we are going to jump into film and TV news in a second. In film and TV news, we'll be talking about a whole bunch of stuff, number of films that are coming out that we are looking forward to, you know, surprises that popped up, one in particular, but we'll talk about that in a few minutes. Later on in the spotlight section, I'm going to be talking to film director as well as film festival director, Mark Brennan, who is going to be talking to me about his short film festival, which is Exit 6 Film Festival. I believe I'm getting the name correct, as well as because he's now joined the team at Genera Films, and they basically fund, or they provide funding for short films. So if you're interested, if you have a short film that you would like to get funded, you definitely want to tune in, or you would definitely listen to our spotlight section, which is coming up in a few minutes, where I talk to Mark Brennan, who can help you get your short film funded. But before all of that stuff, let's jump into film and TV news. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
Producer Dave.
He's just producer Dave, you know, it's like, okay.
No, I said I'm producer Dave.
Oh, okay. It came across just as producer Dave.
He's like, sorry,
I'm producer Dave. What do you want? What do you want, fool? And then move on to the next one. So this came across. I opened up Twitter earlier today, and it just flashed up on my phone. John Boyega has said yes to doing Attack the Block 2. Now, those of you who don't know what Attack the Block is, I guess it was a big film. It was pretty much John Boyega's debut, right? His feature film debut. John Boyega, you recognize him from the new Star Wars films as Finn. He's also in the Small Axe series. One of the, I think it's the Thin Blue Line, if I'm not mistaken. He's coming back for the sequel, Attack the Block. Attack the Block, written and directed by Joe Cornish. It was set in London. It's a 2011, and it's set in South London, where aliens land, or these alien creatures land in an estate in South London. And these kids, these boys, young boys, are basically the last line of defense from these little, these big, ferocious alien creatures that land. It is, I mean, it's like, I saw the advert for Attack the Block, and I knew about Joe Cornish from the stuff that he's done. He was part of a double act with Adam. I think it was Adam and Joe. They were a double act. They talked about films a lot. And then he went and wrote a number of stuff with Edgar Wright and so on and so forth. And I really liked his stuff. And then he was doing this as his debut feature film, right, where he was directing it. And I saw the advert and I saw the kids in it, or the young boys in it. And I always, all the time back then, whenever I'd hear the South London accent, sometimes it's like, not the South London accent. The accent is not the issue that I had. I don't know what I had a problem with it, but every time I saw it on film, it grated. It just made the back of my hair stand up. But I said I was going to go watch it. Just go check it out. And I checked it out, and boy, I was blown away. Sitting there, I was like, this guy, the guy that is playing this lead character I've never seen before, has such presence, such gravitas, even though he's never been in a film before. And I think he's going to do wonders. And hey, I said it to myself. I wish I'd put money down on it. And he became Finn. This is John Boyega. Excellent in the role. Have you seen, I've been rabbiting on about the film. Producer Dave, have you seen Attack the Block?
Yeah, I saw it when it came out. I really enjoyed it. I thought I recognized some of the locations as well, as it's based in South London. I thought it was an interesting and good film. I liked the aliens, which were hairy little beasts with blue teeth. I was hoping it would do better than it did, but it didn't. It lost money.
Did it lose money? I didn't know that.
It didn't make any money at all. It lost money. But in saying that, it became a cult film. It was one of those that lost money in the box office when it was released in 2011, I believe.
Yes. But
over the years, people have been going back and watching it, rewatching it, and saying what a good film it was. And people have been picking up on it. And I think that's the reason why they've greenlit Attack the Block 2, because it's basically 10 years later, 10 or 11 years later, that it's going to happen. So some of those people who are in it obviously have gone. If you haven't seen the film, you go and watch the film, then you'll understand what I'm talking about. But it would be interesting to see what they come up with and how they actually do Attack the Block 2. I'm looking forward to it anyway.
Yeah, I'm surprised it okay, well, no, surprise is a strong word. I can see why it may not have, because I mean, started off my review of it by saying how the accents were grating on me at the time. But it didn't. It didn't. When I started watching it, I got over that really quickly. And if anything, I think now I'm very used to the accent as well. I know why it was grating on me, is because it reminded me of when I first came to the country and I was bullied by my friends who had that accent. So every time I hear the accent, in the back of my mind is like, it's you again. But I've gotten over. I'm now a well recovered, slightly well recovered human being. So that's why it doesn't bother me as much. But I'd say Attack the Block went a long way to making me come to terms with that. But you were saying a number of people that were in it. Jodie Whittaker, who is now Doctor Who. What's his name? Nick Frost from stalwart of Edgar Wright. He was in it as well. A lot of them actually grew into the industry and have started taking on more prominent roles. So it will be fun to see some of those people come back to take on the role. Joe Cornish, you can see straight away, this is a guy who loves films, right? So you can, when you're watching it, it was just the clash of the South London feel, you know, the South London life, those people, the estate, you know, the estate that they were in, the tower blocks that they were in, and then the American film or Hollywood's film style of the, you know, the action set pieces. There's one set piece in particular in the film which really sticks with me. And it's a bit where John Boyega's character he's on one end of the hallway, and it is, he knows he needs to get from one end of the hallway to the other end of the hallway, and you know it's crawling with these creatures, and you know that they're vicious, and if I remember correctly, there's smoke and everything that he sets it up to be able to help get across to that area to either rescue someone or get something. And the slow motion, that scene is shot in slow motion, or it's played in slow motion. And as you see the way he leaps over one bit to next bit, it's pure Hollywood, right? That was the moment I was like, this Joe Cornish nailed it in the direction sense. John Boyega nails it as an action hero from that scene. And he was going to do wonders. Now it's been 10 years. Everybody has gotten better in their craft. John Boyega is now, he's actually a producer on the second film now. So I'm very much looking forward to it. I want to see what they do 10 years later. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave. Another film that's going to be coming out soon is the Aretha Franklin biopic, Respect. This was delayed due to the pandemic. It was due to be released a couple of years after the Amazing Grace film, which was the concert film that was originally recorded in 1972. And it's going to star Jennifer Hudson, who I recently found out was picked by Aretha herself to play her in the biopic. And it's going to star, amongst others, Forest Whitaker, Marlon Rayons, and Mary J. Blige. They're going to be in it. So it's due to be released this year, in August in the US and in September over here, about a month apart. I'm very much looking forward to it because I did so much enjoy watching Amazing Grace. I thought that was an amazing film. If you haven't seen it, very much recommend watching Amazing Grace, but I can't wait to see the biopic.
Jennifer Hudson is one of those actresses where if you're a black singer, you want her to play you in the biopic. Actually, to be honest, I mean, Aretha Franklin is okay because she's amazing. She was amazing, right? She's a legend. She was a legend. She still is a legend. She's dead now. But she can have the confidence to say, I want Jennifer Hudson to play me, because you know that Jennifer Hudson will bring it. I mean, Jennifer Hudson's first film, which was Dreamgirls, she won the Oscar for, right? And so, I can't think of any other person who they would cast to play Aretha Franklin but Jennifer Hudson. I think she'll do an amazing job with it. I wouldn't be surprised if that's another Oscar that she gets.
Well, I can't wait for it anyway. So, you know, we'll see. And just a couple of little tiny bits. If you cast your mind back, I was rabbiting on about a Netflix series called Ragnarok, a new take on the Thor legend set in Denmark in a fictional town called Edda. And this young man comes to live in the town, and he is revealed to be the new reincarnation of Thor. Now, it ran for 6 to 8 episodes. I can't remember exactly. I think it was 6 episodes. Netflix have just revealed that they're going to drop series 2 starting next Thursday, the 27th of May. And I'm looking forward to it. 6 new episodes where he comes into his power and also other gods come in as well. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. That's Ragnarok.
Yeah, I remember you talking about it, and I know that it's one of those things that's on my list. It's on the good list. It's on the list of things that I want to see, not the list of things that people say you should see. And I'm like, okay, I'll put it on the list. Like This Is Us I have seen Neverending Story. So I was gonna keep
you were gonna that. Say Neverending Story.
I was gonna say Neverending Story. It is my Neverending Story list. But I did eventually watch Neverending Story.
Shout out, Laura.
Sorry, hey Laura. Happy birthday, Laura.
Happy birthday, Laura.
Speaking of which, as we're recording this, just want to sing happy birthday to producer Dave, because it's also producer Dave's birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
Happy birthday, producer Dave.
Yeah, I'm going to cut this bit out.
Happy birthday to you. Anyway, okay. I did want to watch Ragnarok. I will watch Ragnarok eventually. Now that season 2 has come out, I can binge watch the 12 episodes. So that's good.
There's also another couple of things. Another one from Netflix that I've rabbited on about was a short series called Love, Death, and Robots. And that's now dropped. Unfortunately, it's not as the series length is not as extensive as the previous one, which was like 12 to 18 episodes. This one is only 6, but I've been watching them, and yeah, the quality is still there. Definitely, definitely, definitely recommend it.
See, I've seen season one. I saw the message popped up recently to say season two had dropped, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna watch it. But my schedule has been way too packed. I've not had the chance to watch it yet. But yes, weekend viewing, second season, Love, Death and Robots. Love that show.
Yeah, brilliant. And the last one, and this is a thank you to Farside Radio, which is also on Resonance 104.4. They played a tune from this series on Netflix called Midnight Diner. And it's a Japanese TV, it's a Japanese series that Netflix have shown. It's got two series in there. I watched an episode, and I can thoroughly recommend it. If you want to see another side of Japan, watch Midnight Diner. It's in Japanese with English subtitles. That should not put you off. But it made me think what a decent job Netflix is doing. Original series in different countries, not just Europe, like you have with All Four, but from around the world. You can see series from that have been made around the world in one place on Netflix. And it's something that a lot of streaming services aren't doing. It's all English language films that we're getting. Only exception to that is All Four, which has The Water Presents, which is mostly European films and TV series on there. But you don't get that necessarily with other streaming services. And I think, well, we are in a global atmosphere. We are in a global pandemic, unfortunately, but we're also in a global setting as well. And you might as well learn something about another culture. So I would definitely recommend watching Midnight Diner because it shows another side of life somewhere else.
I will check it out. I'll do my research and I'll see if I can watch it, if it's something I want to watch. I do love to pick up different things from different parts of the world, especially East Asia. When I get into a phase where I just binge watch all of that stuff, especially Korean thrillers. I want to check that out as well. So I'll get a chance. I'll check it out. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And this is Spotlight. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I am joined by a film director, a film personality that I've been following on various social media platforms and recently on Clubhouse as well, giving me the opportunity to network and bring more people into the Shoot the Breeze family. Please tell us your name and maybe let's start with the film, one of the films that you're most proud of directing that you want to talk about.
Well, hello, Marcus. Thank you so much for having me on the show. My name is Mark Brennan. I am a filmmaker, a film festival director, and also recently operations manager of a new film company called Genera Films. I should rephrase that. They're not a new film company. They've been around since 2017, but I am new to you. That's the difference.
You've just joined the company and immediately like, no, you've made a mistake. You need to...
Already. Yeah. Sorry, boss. Sorry, boss, if you're listening. Sorry about that. No, it's new to me, but it's been great. But in regards to a film that I have made that I'm passionate about, I have a short film on the film festival circuit at the moment called Squall, which is a short drama I filmed in the summer of 2019 across three very sleepless nights and days as well. And I couldn't be prouder of it and all the work that everybody put into it. It's a short drama about two strangers who meet in a hotel bar when they're both at very low places in their lives. And they go on to have an evening where they kind of show each other that maybe not everything is quite so terrible. And a pain shared is a pain lessened, I suppose. And it stars Gary Beadle and Jessica Chamberlain, who are both great. And I couldn't be happier with how it turned out.
That's excellent. And in fact, that's one of sort of you've you've kind of mentioned in the three different areas that I want to discuss. I want to start with the short film, and then we'll move on to your film festival. Your film festival, Exit 6 Film Festival, correct?
That's the badger. Yeah.
Excellent. We'll talk about that. Then we'll move on to your new role in Genera Films, just as long as obviously you still have a job there with them.
Assuming we can only hope, but yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So we'll keep that for the end. So by the time we air this, if you message me and say, you know, unfortunately this has happened and as such we can't, then we can just cut that bit out at the end, no problem.
Awesome.
So really? Let's start with the short film. You mentioned, I mean, you had Gary Beadle in it. A number of people would recognize, and please correct me if I'm wrong. Gary Beadle was from, he's, a lot of the UK audience would recognize him from EastEnders. Is that correct?
Correct, yes.
Yes.
Playing Paul Truman for a number of years.
Yes, and I saw him recently in an episode of Small Axe, which I always forget the name of the episode, but it's the first one. It's about the Jamaican restaurant that has issues with the police and so on and so forth. And he's just he plays a complete, a stark character, the opposite character to his character in EastEnders. So it's sort of, if you want to see range in an actor, just look at EastEnders and then look at his performance in Small Axe. I haven't had the chance to watch your short film yet. Plug, hint, hint. If you can sort that out, that would be great. But what was it like working with Gary Beadle on this project?
It was brilliant. I mean, I was a big fan of Gary's from when he was on EastEnders. I always remember years ago, his final episode is one that I found incredibly moving, the way his character exited the show. And I remember thinking then, that guy's brilliant. And one day, by hook or by crook, somehow I'm going to work on something with him because I think he's brilliant. Didn't know what that thing was going to be, but I knew one day I have to work with that guy because I think he's great. And then when I wrote Squall, he was the only one I wanted for the part, to the point where until I was told no from him, I wasn't even thinking about who else might play that part. Didn't know him, had no connection to him, just went to his agent and presented the project and said when we were hoping to do it and the resources that we had, and it would be great if he could take a look and see if he'd be interested to get involved. And I'm very, very lucky to say that he did. And it went from there. In terms of working with him, it was a whirlwind, a brilliant whirlwind, because we didn't have a chance for anything like a rehearsal before the film shot. So we shot over three nights across a weekend. And I remember I picked Gary up from the train station where we here in Basingstoke, where we shot the film. And that was the first time we met. And then it was sort of in the car, the wow, 5 minutes okay. between the train station to where we were filming, just kind of meet, more of a chat about what we saw for the character, like going forward. And then we just jumped straight into it, you know, and it was brilliant. He was so full of energy and imagination and offering suggestions for the character and suggestions for lines that we could throw in and try different things with, and just a brilliant collaborator. And but yeah, overall I just could not believe how energized he was by the whole thing and just seemed so happy to be there and work with everybody. So he was brilliant, absolute joy.
I know the same may not necessarily apply for a feature film, because obviously you have longer scripts, you have longer, you know, pages of dialogue, but it's still an immense task to have just an entire weekend with no rehearsal, no preparation. As you said, you hadn't even met him. You probably spoke to him before that, but not in any depth for the project. For a consummate professional just to show up on set and really have his lines down ready and also bring suggestions, it's great. He's not there just for the paycheck, if there was a paycheck for a short film, and then go from there. So it's great that you had that experience to be able to go through that. For other people who are looking to do their own films and who may be in your position, what kind of advice can you give for them to follow in order, if they want to get someone like Gary or like other actors in particular that they want in that particular performance, what kind of advice would you give to them to approach such actors of such caliber to be able to get them onto their project?
Well, the only advice I can offer is by doing things the way that I've done them in the past, which is when contacting the agent of an actor is presenting as much information as you can about the project itself. So it's not just a case of here's the script, you know, will they read it and would they like to be in it? It's more a case of, you know, when your shooting dates are going to be, you know, what you can afford as a rate. You present everything kind of all in one hit to save the agent having to come back with a lot of questions as follow-ups, you know, but when are you shooting? Where are you shooting? And what's the budget that you have? You know, who else is involved? If you present everything up front, I think they're all, if you, it shows that you kind of know all the questions that you're going to be asked, and then already kind of shows that you're operating on a level that you understand the way things work, and you understand the information that the actor will want in order to try and, you know, make a decision as to whether or not they can be involved with your project. You know, it might not be anything to do with the script that they might say no. It might be, I love this, but when you plan on shooting, I can't do. And for whatever reason, you have to shoot on those dates, means you have to find another actor. But it would then be a waste of time to find someone who is attached to it, not tell them when your shoot dates are locked for, and then subsequently find out, oh, they're not free that weekend. Like, oh, bugger. we've got to change things up. So in a nutshell, my advice would be to just present as much information about the project and the ask as you can when you make the initial approach.
Fantastic. Thank you for that. To be honest, I'm saying that's for people who are listening. That's for me, because I want to use that as an opportunity to do my own project. I want to get an A-list actor. And so I'll just basically say, this is what we need. This is how much the budget is, exactly when I'm planning on shooting it. Mark told me that you'll say yes for it. So that's good. Let's go to Mark.
Oh, another bit I would add on top of that then is that this is a piece of advice that was given to me by an actor called Bern Gorman, who's involved with Exit 6. And that was the higher profile the actor that you're going for, the less certainty they have over their calendar in the long term. So it's not always worth asking an actor, say you have your shoot dates, but they're a year from now. You know, they don't know a year from now what they're going to be doing and what they can commit to. So aiming slightly more short term is something to consider as well. Anything with a huge lead time, so much can happen, and then, you know, they can't be involved, or your project gets stalled, or, you know, so don't aim for something that's going to be off in the too far in the future, because it just makes it harder for them to say yes, they'd like to be involved, because they can't commit to it.
That is perfect. That fits right into my wheelhouse, which is excellent. And nice tag there, as you mentioned, Exit 6. We'll talk about that in just a second. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm here talking with film director, festival director, and an executive on Genera Films, Mark Brennan. Mark has just mentioned Exit 6 Film Festival. Please tell us what Exit 6 Film Festival is all about.
Exit 6 is an annual short film festival that's hosted in my hometown of Basingstoke. It's been running now for 6 years. This year will be the sixth edition. And we're very lucky that throughout that time, we've been on Film Freeway's top 100 best reviewed film festival list. That's out of roughly 10,000 film festivals that they facilitate around the world. Which
absolutely. I saw that, and I was like, that's enormously impressive, because we talk about, sorry, just to cut you off at that point, I'm literally just adding to what you were about to say. As you were just about to say, the number of film festivals across the world, film festivals pop up everywhere. In London alone, there are easily over 150 different film festivals, both short and feature film festivals. So for you to land in the top 100 by Film Freeway, which is where they just basically, Film Freeway, for those who don't know, is a website that essentially it's your gateway to the film festival world. It's however you want to call it. It's your Facebook for film festivals. You go on there, you register, and you can search for film festivals to submit your films. And they have rated you as, or not you particularly, but Exit 6 as top 100. When did that review come in? And tell us, what were your immediate feelings when you got that news?
Oh, well, it happened, I think, after our first year of running. I mean, the way accolade is awarded is just through the reviews that are left you by the filmmakers that have come through the festival. So they will give a star rating, a little bit like TripAdvisor, I suppose. They will leave a rating, mark you out of five for certain categories, and from that it kind of decides whether or not where you would stand in the review listings. I think the year we started was the first year Film Freeway offered that as a function. So we were very lucky to make it onto the list that year, because we started around the same time, but we've stayed there every year since. And all that fills all of us on the team with is just immense gratitude to the filmmakers that have thought to leave such kind reviews about us, and just glad that they had such a good time being part of the festival that they would tell others that they did. So it makes us all immensely grateful and proud.
So does your film festival, the film, as you mentioned, it's an annual short film festival, so it focuses mainly on short films. Is that a category mainly for the films itself, or do you have various categories for scripts and, you know, actors? What are the categories that you have in Exit 6 Film Festival?
Well, the only real category that we have is that the films will need to be 15 minutes or less in length. With regards to the genres that we program all of them, you know, horror, comedy, drama, you name it, we'll take it. What we're looking for is the execution of a story and the production value behind it, the performances, the cinematography, you know, the whole bag, everything you would look at in a film to decide whether or not you think it's something you really want to share is what we look for. And genre doesn't really come into that. It's more just a case of the filmmaking in itself. So we have a very varied program when the festival is on. In fact, one of my favorite parts of the festival is helping to curate the screening blocks, because we mix them all up. We don't have like a drama block and a comedy block and a horror block. You know, they're very deliberately curated so that no two films are the same genre, if we can help it sit side by side, so that when you're a viewer in that block watching them, you're never kind of comparing the two because they're the same genre. So you'll watch something that is funny 1 minute and it will lead into something that's maybe more dramatic to next. And then that goes into something scary, which goes into something sci-fi, you know, depending on what the program is. And it's all tailored to not just by genre, but those specific films themselves. So we watch the films and decide, okay, which one of these two would go well next to each other, not just because one's comedy, one isn't. You know, we watch what actually happens in these films and think, as a viewing experience, if I was to watch these films back to back, it's like making a mixtape for somebody. You know, you're trying to put together the best kind of flow over a screening block's period. So that's a very long rambling answer to your question. But we take any genre, they all just have to be 15 minutes or less.
Trust me, if you ever listen to this show, that's what we do. I especially ramble nonstop, even when I'm asking questions. Let me try and be concise with this one question. With a number of different film festivals or award ceremonies that have happened over the last few years that have caused or courted controversy, for example, the Oscars and BAFTAs and so on and so forth, where there are certain films that get nominated or get awarded, certain categories get awarded, etc., where as soon as the winner is announced, there's always going to be that controversy of, you know, the less deserving film won or the less deserving actor won and so on and so forth. How do you, as someone who runs a film festival, deal with those kind of issues with regards to actually selecting what you think is, what I guess you want to say is an objectively the obvious choice in a market that is clearly subjective? How do you approach that with your film festival?
Well, the selection process at Exit 6 is incredibly precise. So every single film that's submitted to us is watched by at least three panelists. And then Film Freeway has a facility where you will then rate the film you've watched in, I think, 10 different categories, everything from directing, writing, performance, production value, cinematography, and a few more than that. And our three panelists will judge the film as they see it out of those 10 categories, which gives it an average score out of 10. Now, what we do when we're having our panelist catch-ups, which happens usually three times throughout the submission period, is all the films that score an average score of, say, 7 or above are the ones that are in strong consideration for the program. Everything that is scored sort of a 6 or below are ones that probably aren't quite strong enough to be part of it. But what we also have is a process by which if, say, the three scores of a film are wildly different, like someone gave it a 1, someone gave it a 6, and someone gave it a 10, which would give it an average score of a 7, I think. That's my terrible maths at work there. If it has a wildly
I'll accept. I'm terrible at maths, too. I'll accept.
If we have a wildly differing score across the three, then the rest of the panel watches that film to see what happened there. Like, is it a case that it's a misunderstood genius that it should be a 10, or is it the one that somebody judged, or is it somewhere in the middle? But every film that comes in is viewed properly and thoroughly and judged accordingly, not ever given to one person, because as you say, it's so subjective to be left to one person's opinion. So we spread it across three and then more, should that opinion be quite divisive. And then it's the battle between the panelists. You know, once we've whittled down the films we think should be in consideration for the program, then it's a slanging match between all of us to go, right, we can only fit in this number of films, what are the ones we're going to put in? And then that's a fun part as well, when the panelists argue for different films and fight the corners they want for the films that should be in there and argue why they should be in there. It's a fun but tough part of the process, but it just goes to show, you know, how much passion and interest we have in all the films that come to us.
As festival director, do you ever get tempted at any point to say, well, this is the film I like, so this one is definitely going in, as opposed to...
Oh, tempted, absolutely. Absolutely tempted. I would pull rank every chance I get if I could, but I don't. You know, I like everybody else, I have films that I will fight for, but it's we have to agree as a team, you know, going forward. But I can't think of a time where I've ever had to get in a strop about film to put it in, but
I'm sure the rest of your panel will disagree with you, but we'll
I'm sure they would. Yeah, you're absolutely right, they probably would, but no, we try to keep it, you know, as even and democratic as we can on something that is entirely subjective, as you say.
Yeah, you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I'm speaking with Mark Brennan, who's a film director as well as the festival director for Exit 6 Film Festival, which is Short Film Festival. Am I right that the deadline for this year is the 9th of June?
That's for the regular submission period. I think the late submission period will be, I think it's the 9th of July. I think July is when we actually properly close submissions for this year's program. But 9th of June is when the regular period closes, yes.
Fantastic. What we're going to do is I'll try to remember this. This is why producer Dave needs to be on the show with me whenever I'm doing interviews, because he keeps track of all these things. I say random stuff and completely forget it the next time. So what I'm going to try and do is I'll have this interview play not just next week or the episode is playing, which is this show, which should be next week from when we're talking, but also closer to the 9th of July as well, in case any filmmakers are listening and, you know, just need that extra prompt. If they miss the 9th of June submission, they can at least get the 9th of July. But then the festival runs from the 24th of September to the 3rd of October. Is that correct?
Yeah, which is an interesting thing for us, because before we've always been a one-day festival on the last Saturday in September. But because of the pandemic last year, we were forced to make the move online, and we extended our online festival across a week rather than just a day. And our plan this year is to make a hybrid where our online program for a week leads up to the big finish, which will be the physical festival day at several venues around the town, the View Cinema and the Anvil as well. And going online was an incredibly interesting thing for us. It was nothing, obviously, any festival planned for last year. But then when it came along, it was so much good came out of it for us going online. Our festival, after a film screens, the filmmakers are invited up on stage immediately afterwards for a short Q&A about the making of that film, which is great for the visibility of the filmmakers who join us on the day, but it meant those who weren't able to join us didn't have that experience. And as so many of the films that we program are from overseas, there are a lot of filmmakers that we wouldn't hear from on the festival day. But being online last year, we conducted Zoom Q&As with all the filmmakers that wanted to have a Q&A with the film, which we then edited and put on our festival portal for the festival users to watch at their leisure. If they just watched the film and enjoyed it and they wanted to see the Q&A, it was sat right there next to the film to watch. And because it was a Zoom Q&A and not live on the days it would be at the festival, they often are way longer than 5 minutes they might have at the festival. Some of them are, you know, 15, 20, 25 minutes long, just great group chats about the making of each individual film. So that meant we could include filmmakers from countries we never had been able to before and made the whole event feel a lot bigger. So going online wasn't planned for us, but so much good came from it. We're absolutely keeping those positives going forward.
Absolutely. And with almost every aspect of life that we've encountered since the lockdown, the world has become smaller because of Zoom and because of internet online presence, as you said, now with Clubhouse, where interaction with different people across the world at various times, people can stay longer. You don't have to worry about, you know, taking the train to get to a location, or in your, as you mentioned, flying from one country to the next and dealing with those logistics. You can do it in your bedroom with your underwear, not particularly like that, but just in that case. And it does allow more people the opportunity to be able to do that. So that's fantastic. And you just touched upon a point, which I want to kind of reiterate. How can people get to watch the films that are in Exit 6 Film Festival?
Well, when the festival is going on, we will have our own festival portal set up at exit6filmfestival.com, where people can sign up and register and then view the screening blocks as they would like to see them. Otherwise, it would be, should the hybrid model go ahead, coming down to Basingstoke on the day of the festival and buying tickets either on the day or in the week leading up to it, and join us for a whole bunch of not just film screenings, but, you know, networking sessions and industry workshops and Q&As, all that will lead up to a big party in the evening, which few people leave not blurry eyed by the end of, which it's always a really good time. So if nothing else, it's worth coming down to Basingstoke just for the party at the end of the festival.
Basingstoke is near me and it kind of straddles my birthday, so I might be tempted to come and get drunk.
Be tempted. Come down for sure. Yeah,
absolutely. Absolutely. So let's progress now from that to where you may no longer have a job with, which is Genera Films. Tell us, you have recently been appointed to be part of Genera Films. Tell us, what is Genera Films? What is their main USB or unique selling point? And what is your role now with the team?
Well, Genera Films has been running since 2017, and it's the world's largest company that for funding short films specifically. Up to now, it's supported, I believe it's over 40 short film projects with up to £250,000 worth of funding and support across those 40 projects. And it has 4 funding rounds every year, where short filmmakers can apply for up to £5,000 in funding for their projects, regardless of what stage that project is at. It could still be in development, it could be in production, it could need money for post, it could need money for the film festival submission run afterwards. And that's, it's been a platform that's grown from strength to strength since it was started by the CEO and founder, Christian Parton, who has brought me on board to help with an upcoming expansion that should be launching in the next month or so that we're all very excited about.
So you've pointed out it particularly targets short films, and as such, people who are making short films can apply and get funding for it. I was on the website recently, and if I remember correctly, you had about 3 different windows to apply. Is that correct? Is that sort of the format where you apply within a specific window, and then your project gets evaluated and determined whether you get the funding? Is that correct?
Yeah, there are different funding rounds that run, I think, for 3 months at a time. So they will happen 4 times a year. The one that's open at the moment will close at the end of June. So there's, and then a new one will start immediately afterwards that will be then carry on for 3 months after that. And then at the end of the 3 months, the projects that are selected for support will receive their funding. And the best thing about, I think, Genera funding is that there's no strings attached to it. There's no creative input required from Genera. There are some funding bodies out there that once you've been awarded funds, they want to have a say in the film you're going to make and how you're going to make it. And that can sometimes alter, change entirely in some cases the film that the filmmaker wanted to make in the first place, rightly or wrongly. But what's great about Genera is that the trust is put completely in the filmmaker. You know, they know the film they want to make. They know the vision they have. And Genera Films just wants to help them get there. So that's one of the things I love about being part of this company.
That's it's a great idea, as you've mentioned. And it, as someone who has tried to or has made films in the past, short films especially, and looking to move into the feature film sector, I know how difficult it is to try and raise funds in order to make films, especially when you're starting out. So any avenues like Genera Films who are willing to put that off, you know, available, make available for people to do that is fantastic. With regards to the idea of short films, and this is coming off of a conversation that we had with Jed Shepherd, who is the writer and executive producer of Host, which is on Shudder. Now, his film on Shudder is about 55 minutes long. And so that sparked the conversation about how long is a short film, how short is a feature film. So what criteria does Genera Films have for what is considered as a short film?
Do you know what? That is an excellent question. I've never looked up to see if there is an actual duration limit on the short film that Genera would support. I think maybe the reason is because lately short films that get made, so few of them are anything over 20, 25 minutes long for festival consideration. Host, in my mind, is definitely a feature film. I think the official, according to, I think it's the Academy, a feature film is anything that's over 45 minutes long. My memory might be failing me there, but I think that was used to be the official kind of what's a short and what's a feature. And it was 45 minutes and over was a feature. But festivals across the circuit these days tend to program anything 20 minutes and under. You know, I very rarely see short films made these days that are 25 minutes and over. That's not to say they're not being done by any stretch, but because festivals by nature tend to program things that are 25 minutes and under, more so 15 minutes and under, most short films now that are getting made tend to aim for that length. Otherwise, they're making it very difficult for themselves to be programmed, and they're very much reducing the number of festivals they could be selected for.
So, and that's great. So the fact that you've identified, if I understood you correctly, you're identifying anything that is under 25 minutes as a project that you could, so if anybody out there right now has a short film that they're working on and they see it, maybe it might hit about 30 to 35 minutes and they're looking for some funding and want to approach Genera Films, would you suggest that they may restructure their film to be under that 25 minute mark in order to be able to appeal to the funding body?
Potentially, but I think more so for festival consideration, if that's something that they would like. You know, the number of film festivals that would take a film that's 30, 35 minutes long is not many. And for that reason, you'd automatically be kind of hamstringing yourself in the visibility that film might get on the film festival circuit. So already my suggestion would be, even before considering where to fund the film, was, does it need to be 30, 35 minutes long? If so, what's your plan for it? If it's a festival run, I would think very carefully about the length of it, purely for that reason, just because you're making it very hard for yourself, or harder than it needs to be for that film to be programmed. With regards to Genera, I don't think that would make a difference. But like I say, yeah. Before even getting to that point, if the point of making the film is to put it at festivals to show what you can do, you'd be making life much harder for yourself by making a film that long.
That's great. And I pretty much figured the same thing as well. And just to ask this question for a friend, just if the person had a feature film and that they were seeking funding, could they still apply to Genera Films, or is it strictly just for short films?
It is strictly just for short films. There have been some applications that come in for features, but we have to kind of stipulate, you know, it's someone who would have a budget for a feature film that say it's going to cost $1 million, but it would be great if we could start with £5,000 from you. It doesn't really.
You got to start somewhere.
Really do well. So, well, exactly. Yeah. But no, short films is absolutely what Genera Films is aiming for.
That's good. I'll tell my friend that they should go someplace else rather than Genera Films. So it's okay. It's producer Dave. I'll tell producer Dave. It's fine. Okay. Excellent. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko, and I've just been speaking with film director as well as festival director of Exit 6 Film Festival, and a new employee, new operative executive. What is your role on Genera Films?
I'm operations manager.
Operations manager, that's it. I don't know why I keep going executive operations manager, but it's operations manager of Genera Films, that they help with funding short films. So if you have a short film, please contact, don't contact Mark Brennan directly, but go on to Genera Films and find out, you know, how you can apply for that funding, as well as if you have a short film that's already, that's ready, that needs to go into a film festival. Exit 6 is a great way to get contact. So Mark, I want to ask you, what are the social media links and the URLs that people can follow to either follow you, to follow Exit 6 Films, or to follow Genera Films?
Well, to follow me, it's Mr. Mark Brennan on Twitter. And I think it's Mr. M. Brennan on Instagram. I've not been very consistent there. For Exit 6, I think it's just Exit 6 Film Fest across all platforms. And for Genera Films, I think it is just Genera Films. At Genera Films is the handle across all our platforms.
Don't worry about being inconsistent when it comes to social media handling. That's what we are with in Shoot the Breeze. On Twitter, it's at STB_ResonanceFM. On Instagram, it's Shoot the Breeze Show. And on Facebook, it's Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. So we got scolded by social media guru Elise Quevedo, who basically said, what are you thinking? Just be, you have the same name for every single thing. I'm like, I don't know. Didn't know how, that's how we go where we are. So it's
I get it.
Yeah, it's working for us, so it's fine. So just one last question I want to cap before we cap off our conversation. You've already told us about Squall, which is a short film that you've done, which is now on the festival circuit. What films are you planning on working on? What's your next project for you as a film director?
For me as a film director, the answer is I don't have one currently, because I've been so busy with other work that I haven't been able to sit down and write anything, which breaks my heart, obviously, because writing is what I love doing. And seeing Squall on the circuit and getting the lovely response that it has and remembering making it means I'm desperate to go back to making something else. But I haven't got that something else just yet. At the moment, my focus is getting Exit 6 up and running for this year and the work for Genera that I'll be doing when the new expansion launches, hopefully next month.
That's fantastic. And you can easily fall into that cyclical workload where as soon as Exit 6 finishes and then you get the Genera film stuff up and running and it's now time for you to start working on your own project, it's now time for Exit 6 to come again and so on and so forth. So
yeah, that really does happen. I mean, I made a short film called Tifa 2 that I shot in November 2014, and that went on a festival circuit the following year, including a festival up in York called Aesthetica, which was great to be part of. And that was kind of what sparked the desire to start our own festival here in Basingstoke. And then since that film, I hadn't made another one until Squall. You know, a few others projects had come and gone and fallen by the wayside, but mostly it was working on things beside filmmaking that meant it took another 4 or 5 years before I shot another short film. And I don't want that to happen again. So I don't count last year because of COVID. So I'm now 1 year since making the last one. So I need to make another one soon, I hope.
No one's counting last year. 2020 just didn't exist. It's a gap in everyone's CV, as in just leave it, an asterisk, as they call it. Just put an asterisk next to 2020 and everybody understands. Do you have plans to move from shorts and into doing feature films?
Yes, yeah, definitely. I think there's another short I'd like to make first, perhaps in something in a slightly different genre to what I've done before. But then after that, for definite feature films is where I'd be looking to try and make a step up.
Excellent. Mark Brennan, thank you very much for joining us on Shoot the Breeze. I hope, you know, whenever you have any other projects that you're talking about and when you want to talk more about Genera Films' new initiative, please feel free to come back on the show and talk to us about it.
Will do. Thank you for having me.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
I'm producer Dave.
And that was myself speaking with Mark Brennan, who is a director and a film festival director, as well as a new employee. Hopefully after this episode, he doesn't get fired, as I joked on the show, from Genera Films. So again, just to recap, if anybody is making a short film and you want to get funded, go check out Genera Films, because they're doing great work helping to fund short films to help people develop their talent as a storyteller, as a film creator. Go and do it. give them some money. Say shout out from Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. And thank you all very much for staying tuned, downloading our podcast, which comes out every Monday, listening to us on Resonance FM. I want to thank Resonance FM as well for giving us the opportunity to spend an hour and rant and rave and chat about various films. But anyway, I want to thank everybody for tuning in and listening to us. I am Marcus Impacco.
I'm still producer Dave.
Thank you very much for listening.
Speak to you all next week.
Goodbye.
Bye.